morning, good evening. Hey, Frank, how you doing? Welcome to Living Light Dark to Dawn Rock Solid, the place where you come to expand your thinking and elevate your way of being. How are you all doing out there in podcast land? Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you might be listening, if you're listening to the recording and the playback. I hope everybody's doing well. Welcome to June 1st. It is June 1st. Yippee. I mean, is that a good or bad thing? I think it's good. The time is flying by, that is for sure. I hope you all had a wonderful Memorial Day weekend. How was it? I hope it was great. Well, let me see. I was here Tuesday. Tuesday was already after Memorial Day weekend. So, but you know, I could say that again because maybe you didn't listen. You know, coming to you from Hunterdon County as usual. Here to inspire, elevate, motivate, and all those things. And I hope that's how you feel just better all the more and just better for listening. GP Man 45's in the house. How you doing? You know, I wondered. I haven't seen you around in a while, Frank. I actually thought of you earlier, and I guess that meant you were going to show up. So here you are. I hope you are doing great. Scooter Bean won't be here. Scooter Bean has his drum circle every Thursday nights. He lives in Arkansas. Siloam Springs. Really, really great area over there. There's a lot of really radical stuff going on in the ground in over there in Arkansas. But in any case, like, you know, energetically with crystals and things that are in the ground. And I know that might sound strange to some people, but in any case, he started doing a drum circle when he's in Asheville, North Carolina. Asheville, North Carolina is an absolutely outstanding place. It's just absolutely incredible. The whole city is lit. The whole town is lit. It's a very diverse community, diverse cultures and all of that. And they have a square, like a town square. It's a town park and it has steps that you kind of walk down to. And there's steps that it's almost like, well, there's steps that go around that surround it. And in any case, it's not a square, it's a circle, but it's kind of in the center of town. And there's a landscape a little bit and trees and grass and stuff. And so anyway, it's just really pretty. It's hard to describe. But so all through the warm months, when you can be outdoors, they do a drum circle. I think it's every Friday night. And it was the most amazing experience I'd ever had. You know, it's very memorable. And the whole city is just filled with, you know, love and light and just unity things and posters and stuff just all over the place. But anyway, and I have announcements to make, so I should probably cut this short. But so that's where he was from, or not where he was from. He lived there for a short while. He moved back to Arkansas. That's where he was born and raised in Arkansas. And he decided to just start his own drum circle. And so I give him a lot of credit for this. He is a drummer. He's been a drummer since he was little. He plays a regular set and he plays another more percussion set with timbales and different drums I can't pronounce. But so it's going pretty well so far. It's every Thursday night there in the amphitheater. And he's been doing it. I think this is maybe the third week. And it's, there's people, you know, word's starting to get out. People are showing up and I'm hoping it's going to grow. We're, you know, believing that it's going to grow into something like Asheville. This thing in Asheville is so big. It's so large. Hundreds of people come and it's just, you could hear it from like a mile away. It's just when they're playing. And it's just an incredible experience. And there's no one leads it. Nobody instructs it. Everybody just starts to play and they all get into a rhythm energetically. And they all just sort of, they go with the flow with each other. And it's really profound. And so that's what his intention is. And I'm so happy for him that he's doing this. But so that's where he is on Thursday nights. So he won't be here on Thursday nights in the live studio. Hey, Ellie. I think I said, hey, GP Man 45 and Frank, and how you doing, Ellie? I'm glad you guys are here. Kerry should be signing on any minute. Hopefully he will be here. He usually never misses. But so, yes, coming to you from Hunterdon County, New Jersey, it was a whopping 88 degrees tomorrow. It looks like tomorrow is going to be 93 or something. It's supposedly 85 right now, but it's very cool inside where I am. Yeah, it looks like 93 degrees tomorrow, but then it's going back down to the 70s for a while. So I'm not... You know, I like the heat. I can tolerate the heat better than the ice. I definitely like the heat better than ice in the winter, but I'm not ready to get into that steamy heat humid all through from now until September. You know, I don't mind starting June a little on the, you know, just the warm side. The past week, it's got to be 7 days now. We haven't had any rain. We're going to need some rain soon. And I thought rain was coming, and it doesn't look like it's in the forecast. Possibly a shower tomorrow. That might be good. And then, but up until like the following Wednesday, which is a very long time, it looks like, you know, we need the farm. It's the Garden State. So we're with the corn and the tomatoes and all the vegetation and the vegetables and stuff and all the farms, and we need the gardens and all this. We need rain for everything to be pretty. This is episode 224. The title is Follow Through to You. It's going to be a good one. I have no idea. I'm not going to say no idea. I don't have an exact idea what I'm talking about. I float from the heart, shoot from the heart as usual. But before I get into that, I want to share a couple of announcements. David Medansky, Stop Dieting, Start Thinning, his latest book, Health Coach, sequel to Breaking the Chains of Dieting, amazing human being, man, husband, father, the whole package he is. He's just a great guy. And he is helping people lose weight and keep it off because he, and that sounds so cliche, but he went on his own journey after trying every diet under the sun and doing everything that he could to try to lose weight. And he did a radical turnaround, changed his diet, started really taking care of his body. And he's written two books about it. Now he's a life coach and he does podcasts, guest appearances, and different things. And if you are looking for a total health and wellness person to consult with, he's your guy. Do check him out. Google him. David Medansky, Stop Dieting, Start Thinning. My scholarship program, it was developed last year to help potential clients afford being able to work with me every once in a while. I actually just had a consultation with someone last week. And, you know, at the end of the day, this person couldn't actually, you know, proceed because of funding. And that seems to be the case. I do not take insurance payments. I am a professional. Absolutely. I do not take insurance. And so it's cash out of pocket. And so this scholarship program helps. If you feel so inspired, you can find me in Venmo or Zelle. No donation is too small, and it definitely helps people. So that being said, happy Thursday. There's Carrie. Hey, Carrie, how you doing? And let's see, it's tough to deal with cold weather. Yes. And so, and everybody's saying hello and greeting each other in the live studio. I just love it here. It's so much fun. Margie Pargie, giving those two gals a shout out because they're loyal listeners. And New Jersey just hit a whopping 75,000 downloads. Right after Tuesday's episode, it went right up to 75,000. So we hit that milestone. It is now 75,300 downloads as of now. So thank you so much for all the listeners. New Jersey's in the top spot. They always have been. They probably always will be. Thank you, guys. And I'm just thrilled. I'm absolutely thrilled and honored that people are listening. And that's a heck of a lot of downloads. And so moving right along. So Saturday's a full moon, by the way. I was going to say that at the end, but don't forget the full moon. It'll be June 3rd, full moon, the first full moon of the, you know, the warmer, I guess it's not really summer. Summer, the first day of summer is the 20th. So we're not summer yet. It's still technically spring. So we don't need the 95 yet degrees because it's still spring, but you never know in the Northeast here. So moving right along, follow through to you, talking points, intro, healthy acceptance, word and credibility. Wondering of others, being forthright, spiritual scapegoating. That's a good one. Unattractive competition, your signature energy, and so much more. And so why am I talking about this? Well, that's a good question. And I only came up with it about an hour ago. I was kind of, you know, just being chill today among all the other stuff I was doing. And I really, nothing was coming to me. And I feel like I have exhausted every topic under the sun. I mean, this is 224. And you know, I feel like, you know, what have I not talked about? And then boom, something happens. And just like Tuesday night, do have a listen to that. That was a good one. Intrinsic divine identity. That was a good one. I shared some of my personal story from 30 years ago. I was a little emotional sharing it. It was really good. I want people to know some of my story, and I share bits and pieces of it all throughout. I've been sharing bits and pieces of it all throughout this podcast. And so I was like really thinking, well, what's going on? What could I talk about? What do people need to hear? What is it? And so I was sitting here and all of a sudden, and this is woo-woo, it's weird, and that's okay. You know how I flow here. You know how I do. And this blue jay, the blue jay came right up to the door, like right up to the door. And I was like, wow, this thing is just really, and the blue jays are big. They're big birds, you know, those baby ones, of course, but this was quite a large one. So I looked it up for the heck of it. I looked up, you know, blue jay. And the message that came up was, you know, you need to follow through on everything that you do. And before that happened, the word gently went through me, very lightly went through me, follow through. And I take those as messages and signs and things that I'm kind of being guided. I mean, again, you know how I roll. And so being guided. And so the phrase follow through went through me. And then all of a sudden, Blue Jay shows up, and that was a message. I said, okay, I have to talk about this. So don't blame me, people, if you don't like what I'm going to say. Not that you wouldn't, because I'm not, you know, and I always say there's never any shame or judgment in anything that I say. So, but you can go to the squad, go to God and universe about this one, because this is what I've been directed to talk about. Like, so that's it. Follow through to you. What does that really mean? So I'm not quite sure where to start, but I'm just going to flow from the heart. Follow through to you. So, well, isn't it frustrating when you encounter situations with people, whether it's a customer service experience over the phone, whether it's, you know, a friend, a spouse, a coworker, somebody at work, or just any kind of an encounter where someone says they're going to do something and they don't follow through on it. And I'm talking about, I mean, it's become I don't want to say normal, but it's become just regular practice anymore for a very long time. Oh, we'll do lunch. We'll get together. Yeah, I'll give you a call. And nobody ever does. You never get together. And that's it. Years go by and you run into that person again and we should get together. It never happens. And I don't know why people do that. I guess people do that to try to be friendly or to try to be nice or to say like, oh, we should do this. And then it just never really happens. And so that's not a real intense example of not following through, but these kinds of things, I shouldn't say intense, serious example. Although like if I meet up with someone and they say, let's get together, I tend to be a face value person. I've always been a face value person. If you tell me something, I'm going to take you at face value. You know, I tend to, I don't know if I talked about it on Tuesday, black and white, on, off, you know, either or. I used to be very, very black and white with absolutely everything. And there's a lot of gray in life. You know, I had to learn that the hard way. There's a lot of gray where every situation or circumstance is unto its own context. Not everybody thinks the same and et cetera, et cetera. And I had to learn that not everything is black and white. And so just because of how I am and what I would do or not do, you tend to project that out to other people. You tend to, you know, feel like, well, I would never do that to someone, or I would never say that, or I would never act like this, or I follow through, I keep my word. And so you would hope that other people would. And the reality is they don't all the time. They just don't. And you have to learn how to accept that. You have to learn who you consider, you know, real close friends and who you consider tribe in your life that are really there for you and loyal no matter what, through the ups, the downs, the ebbs and flows. You have to just really be, you know, discerning about that and wise unto it, because otherwise, you know, it was like a long time ago. You know, I mean, you know that I don't have family here. You know that I am, you know, I'm single at the moment, hoping that's going to change soon. But yes, I'm single at the moment. And I'm fine. I totally love my life. I do. I am content. And it's, and there's arguments surrounding that word content. That, well, if you're content, that means, you know, you really don't have desires. And it's like, no, I have desires. I'm just not restless about it. I'm not restless. I'm at rest. I go with the flow. I do have desires. I do have a desire for a soulmate, for a divine union. But I'm not going to go out and be driven by anxiety or neediness, you know, that needy energy, which I've talked about that before in podcasts. There's healthy need and then there's attachment. And I've had my share of attached relationships and that's what I mean when I say that I'm content. Like I'm content with this while waiting for the appropriate situation to happen. So, because of this, you know, years back, I would have very high expectations for, you know, where friendships are concerned. And I had to learn that, you know, what is a healthy expectation? What is it? And I've called it respectations versus expectations, because people tend to use expectations as an excuse to shirk responsibility. You know, they'll just use, because there's this thing out there, you know, in the community, in the spiritual community or energy community, what have you, just in life, that, you know, expectations are, you know, people don't hurt you, your expectations do. So somebody came up with that phrase. So people tend to use that as a way to shirk responsibility. Oh, well, you just have too many expectations. It's like, well, no, there's a balance with this. There's a balance between, you know, the respectations, you know, the healthy expectation of, well, if you have plans to get together, or if you do have a friendship, it is healthy to expect someone to call you back, to text you back, to email you back, to show up, to be on time, to not cancel at the very last minute. Things like this, you know, there are healthy expectations. I did a podcast on this quite a while ago. excuse me. But so I didn't have the most healthiest expectations, because I was alone a lot, you know, when I wasn't in a relationship with someone after I got divorced, et cetera. You know, there's no family here. It was just me. And so sometimes when I just really wanted a friend and there was no one around, I would get, you know, unusually upset. And it's not a healthy way to be in friendship. And so I had to learn, but there does come a time, you know, after I matured and healed out of that situation, there comes a time where, you know, there is absolutely normal expectations in relationship. There is. I mean, it's relationship, friendship, marriage, it's a two-way street. It's a back and forth. It is a flow of energy. It is a vibration. It is, you know, all of that. But there is some practical stuff that takes place, you know, in relating. And it's not all, they're not all negative and bad expectations. And so that's from where I'm talking about. And all of it comes from the follow through to you. You know, everything we experience, mostly relationships in life, is as a result of who we are and how we're connected to ourselves within ourselves. So follow through to you really means, you have your own self-respect. You have your own self-honor. You have you're aligned within your own self. The whole do unto others thing, you know, what you wouldn't want done to you, you don't do to anybody else. You don't disrespect anybody else. You don't, you know, not return anybody else's phone calls. You don't, you know, so GP man said, move to Texas. You know, I've been to Texas a couple times. I think, how many people? I went to Dallas once, didn't make it to the Cowboys Stadium on business. And then I went another time. I drove through Texas when I drove across the country. So I had a brief stint. I stopped in Texas for dinner and I had a really good steak and that was it. So I guess he does. It seems like he lives in Texas. GP man 45. He lives in Texas. Obviously. I guess I'm assuming. Wow. He lives in Dallas. Are you a Cowboys fan? Football fan here. You know, football fan, big time. Yes. So a lot of people, especially after COVID, fled to Texas. So he is a Cowboys fan. Very cool. They fled to Texas because Texas was one of the only states that were patriots. And I ran into a friend, and I don't want to change the subject, but I ran into somebody. When was it? Okay. It had to be 2021. It had to be that because I was living here. So it wasn't last year. I think it's 21. And someone had just gotten back from Texas. And it was once we were dealing with all the masks, the mask mandates and lockdowns and all this crap. I was surrounding all the mask stuff. And he had just gotten back from Texas. And I think it was Dallas he was in. He's like, Dawn, I just got back from Texas. He's like, there's none of this going on down there. He's like, I might get the heck out of there and move to Texas. Get the heck out of here and move to Texas. He's like, everybody's got flags. Well, you know, everybody's free. No one's wearing masks. There's no mandates going on there. And everybody, you know, they have their guns. They have their, you know, and I'm not for violence either. Okay. But it is the Second Amendment. And I'm very, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, I'm a patriot. I'm telling you, I'm a patriot through and through. And that doesn't mean that I'm, you know, into violence. I'm not into that. And that's what they're trying to make you feel like. That's what this whole thing is, what they are trying to make us feel like, that you're violent if you own a gun. And it's ridiculous, because guns don't kill people. People kill people. People with issues kill people. And it's not always mental illness. And I don't even want to get into that subject. But so what did he say? My gun owns a gun. I believe you. I believe you. And I know that. I was like, here, Carrie, I'm looking for a job in Fort Worth. I live there. Are you? You didn't say. Because he's been wanting to get back to Texas. Oh, my God. That's awesome. I'm so happy to hear this, Carrie. I knew you'd be at some point. Yay. Let's all send Carrie good energy to get back to Texas. I know that's where he wants to be. That would be absolutely amazing. I would be so happy for you. That would be incredible. Oh, my gosh. I have friends there. I have a few friends there. Barbara Simons lives there. David Michelle Anderson live there. There's a few people. I don't know why there's a few people that live in Texas. Very, very cool state. I mean, I have to say, you know, I need a beach though. See, that's my problem. I need the beach. I cannot be. I'm your friend. That's cute. I'm your friend too. Thank you, GEP. I need the beach. I have to be near the coast. I can't be landlocked. I can't just go to a lake. Lakes are great. I live in the woods here, but I can get to the beach in an hour and 10. I can get in the car and be at the beach in an hour and 10. And I have to be near the ocean. I'm an ocean girl. I have to be near water. I have to at least be an hour's worth away from the beach. So that's the issue with that, you know, because New Jersey it's New Jersey. But our food is amazing. You know, I don't go to the city anymore. I have to be in New York. I used to have to go to the city like at least twice a year. You know, I used to always have to go into the city, especially Little Italy. But since all the stuff, and you know what I'm talking about, I won't go into the city. I mean, there's just riots, and you want to talk about guns, you know, and I can't go there. But there's a lot of just random shootings in areas of the city that normally wouldn't be. You know, like there may be Brooklyn, areas of Brooklyn, maybe Harlem, maybe like the not so great areas of New York City, but they're happening like downtown, midtown. That's the place to go. You know, Broadway, Times Square. I mean, it's like am I supported and protected? Absolutely. I believe that I'm supported and protected, but I'm also supported and protected by wisdom, by using my brain. And Little Italy is right next to Chinatown, and that whole area is a little sketchy. It can be a little sketchy. You have to stay right on Mulberry. You really kind of don't want to troll around too much. You got to be careful. There's some areas you got to walk through to get to your car sometimes, and it's a little like, I wouldn't feel so comfortable. You know, these festivals and stuff. And the San Gennaro Festival, I used to go to this every year. Every September, they're there for like 2 weeks. Maybe it's 9 days. It's just food fest, Italian street party all day and night with music and games and booze and fun and stuff. And I used to go every single year, and I haven't been because of all that. So, but I'm looking to maybe leave New Jersey at some point. I've left several times. But anyway, I'm off the subject. It's 24 minutes in. So healthy acceptance, word and credibility. So we're only going with this follow through. The follow through is, so it is normal. I'm just going to shoot from the hip, shoot from the heart. It is normal to want to be accepted. It's healthy to want to be. We all want to be accepted. If we didn't want a certain level of acceptance, and I know like the spiritual community will say, oh, you know, you have wounds if you have a need to be accepted. There's healthy need, there's toxic need. We want to be accepted. We all want to be to be connected. We're supposed to be in connected friendships and relationships. And it's like to have healthy acceptance. You gain, and I'm going to mix all this kind of together. There's a certain measure of follow through that is building your credibility. It builds your credibility. And the spiritual, you know, and I'm going to say this is not a religious show. I've said that 100 times. This is not a religious show. It's definitely not a religious show. It's not a spiritual show, but I do talk about spirituality because we're all hearts and souls having a human experience. And so I do incorporate this in. And what I have found is a lot of spiritual people, which I am, Definitely listen to today's podcast. I talked about this pretty extensively on Tuesday. But, you know, in this, the spiritual people that are kind of so much into, and I am into this, but I consider myself to be grounded and balanced between the multiverse, the multidimensional stuff. And it's all really heart-centered living is what it is. If you're heart-centered and you live from your heart, you're spiritual. You might not call yourself spiritual, but you already are because you're living from heart space, and that's where all the energy is in your heart body. And so a lot of spiritual people will over-spiritualize things, you know, and they use it to scapegoat, to get to make excuse and to scapegoat why they don't follow through, why they don't keep their word, why they don't do certain things. And, you know, in the churches, it was, well, God didn't lead me to do that. Well, you know, God didn't lead me to do this, that, or the other. You know, I didn't feel led by God. The Spirit didn't move me. I wasn't moved by the Spirit. You know, I said this was one of the first quotes I ever made, or a thought that I ever made something out of, and this probably goes back. I was in Flemington when I said this, I think. And that was before I moved to California. So this goes back to 2010. Awakening is really just a return to common sense. Awakening. And we are in a grand shift and a grand awakening. And it really is just a return to common sense in many ways. And you've heard that before. What do you mean, Carrie? Oh, that he must. So there is a delay, like I'm talking and there is a delay. And I think that's on purpose in case something weird happens and you can kind of. So I think there is a delay. But so being moved by the Spirit, he's probably responding to. What was I saying? And so it was. I just lost my thought because I went to Carrie's comment. What was I saying? Oh, boy. Here, let's. I'm going to take a sip of my water. Well, I'm talking about the spiritual community. I'm talking about the spiritual community. People that are spiritual, that will use all kinds of different excuses and things and phrases, whatever, to shirk owning responsibility. And because we're in a vibration, just because we are in a higher frequency, or I don't even know how to say this correctly, because all these words, sometimes you can't get a real meaning from words, and then people get into semantics. Well, that's not how you're really supposed to say that. And this is how you're not really supposed to say this. But you know, if you're heart-centered living, that's what I was saying. So it's really just heart-centered living. It's being spiritual. It's keeping your word is spiritual. You know, it is accountability and credibility and character is spiritual. You know, the grand awakening and the shift is really the return to common sense, which means you do kind of do these things. And I'm not talking about the doing that I talk about a lot. That is part of being, you know, the human being, of being cognizant, of being, you know, being attentive, being credible, keeping your word, building your credibility. Like when you have a new relationship or friendship with someone, it takes time because trust and credibility is established over time. You've heard me say that 100 times. And so if you're constantly, you know, kind of going off over here and going off over there, you're going offline and not letting anybody know for extended periods of time. And then you show back up and everybody's like, where'd you go? And you've had like this presence and things. I just think that, you know, it's not that you have to explain yourself, but it has everything to do with follow through, and people follow through to others through the measure of that they respect themselves. Everything is through self-respect. Everything is through how we feel about ourselves. And everybody has blind spots where they normally, you know, like you might not see something very clearly. And so a lot of it's, in other words, it's not in their awareness. And so people do things that they don't mean to do. It wasn't intentional, but there's a blind spot or there's something that they're not aware of. Common sense has largely gone down the toilet. And I'm not saying this, with shame or judgment, but it really has. And, you know, a lot of this COVID just kind of broke, COVID broke everything up with the order of the way that things were. You know, going to work, going to the office, just the way that the system was. And I'm talking about there was a good part of the system. There was a system that was working. A lot of the bad system fell apart through this, which is good, but a lot of the good things also fell apart. And if you notice, especially in some businesses, there's, I mean, everything's offshored. People are working from home. A lot of people I have found are not always quick to respond to emails, to phone calls. There's no follow through. And especially, I mean, in relationships and in business, if you want to keep your friends and you want to keep your friends and you want to sustain your friendships, I should say, and you want to have a good business, follow through is so important. It's mandatory to follow through, to show up, to be dependable. And this is spiritual stuff. This is all based on the connection to yourself. The connection to yourself is spiritual. There's nothing so woo-woo about it. And I know that we tend to get into the woo-woo of stuff. And I'm woo-woo. I've shared in past podcasts. I can be very woo-woo. I'm very connected to the grounds here. And this is like the enchanted forest where I live. And it's a bird sanctuary. And I love, you know, and I listen and I love the trees and I love connecting with the earth and I love grounding. And there's so much more depth that I have to myself. But there's balance to all of this as long as we're walking on this earth, as long as our feet are touching the ground. And so, you know, the credibility and the character is spiritual. And I think people forget this. And so they start saying, well, you know, in the church, the spirit didn't move me. And so now in the spiritual community, it's like, well, you know, we don't vibe anymore. And it's like, no, it's not that you don't vibe anymore. You just don't want to have a conversation. You're afraid of having a conversation. There's some kind of fear driving this. And fear normally drives inconsistency. Fear drives everything because love shows up, right? Love is healthy. Love is connected. Love wants to be connected. Love is up front and center. Love is radiant. Love is magical. Love is present. Love pays attention. Love is those things. And so when those things are not happening, there's usually a blind spot somewhere of fear. And a lot of times, you know, if there has been any sort of misuse or abuse in a person's life, a trauma, a wound, they tend to go default to a place where they have a hard time admitting their blind spots. They have a hard time admitting they've done something wrong. They have a hard time, and I hate to say wrong, right and wrong, made a mistake, that they made a mistake, which is you mistook things. And sometimes people have a hard time doing this because they still have a wound in that place where they had a super critical parent. I have to write this down. A super critical parent or guardian. And when you're raised with super criticism or unacceptance, it tends to make you feel inferior or on the defensive. Super criticism, inferior, defensive. Now, you know how I roll here. I shoot from the heart and I don't have notes. I take notes while I'm talking. That's what I do. So, that's what happens. And so when you have someone who hasn't healed their wound of being criticized, or some of their inferiority or their insecurity, they tend to not want to own up to mistakes and apologize and take responsibility or just take responsibility. Relationship is a responsibility. It's a responsibility if you want in marriage to your spouse, to your boss, to your employee, to your clients, your patients, your customers. It's a responsibility. And somewhere we have lost just the thread and the foundation of responsibility. It's gone down the drain. And so the only ship that don't sink are friendships. The only ships that don't sink are friendships. That's cute. That's cute. And so for some reason, whether you have gone to church or whether you're in the spiritual community, responsibility kind of goes out the window. It's like, well, I'm spiritual now and I just kind of fly by the seat of my yoga pants. Fly by the seat of my yoga pants. I mean, just because we're spiritual now, doesn't mean we just go with the flow and we just kind of drop everything. We drop everything. I mean, we drop everybody. It's like, well, I'm just going with the flow now. So if I'm not going to show up, I'm just going to do what I feel like doing and whatever I feel like I'll do. What I don't feel like doing, I won't do, because this is how the spirit is guiding me. This is how my team is guiding me. This is how my squad is guiding me. So I just don't really need to keep my word for anything or follow through on a damn thing. Like, first of all, I just, oh my goodness, I have to. Because you are aligned and connected to yourself. It's when you are following spiritualism and all the practices and all the woo-woo stuff so much, and you're all about that, that the common sense is still kind of absentee. The responsibility is absentee. Because now, and so I think what has happened is people have used spiritualism as bypass, and I've talked about this a lot, but I'm incorporating it into this. And so spiritualism is used as a bypass to not want to heal the wound that can't follow through, that feels uncomfortable, because sometimes there's uncomfortable situations. It's just life. We're human. Everybody's human. Like I said, people have blind spots. People make mistakes. And it's in those mistakes, it's in those places that is requesting growth. It's an invitation to grow. It's an invitation to heal. It's an invitation to expand. And if with the bypass, it's, well, I'm just going to use the rocks and the crystals and the sage and the candles and the yoga and the singing bowl meetings and all these different, you know, practices of maybe going to church and prayer meetings and choir, whatever it all is, whatever all this stuff all is, to escape. It's escapism. And we're escaping. And the follow through piece, yeah, Carrie, if it wasn't God's will, that's a good one. That's another good one. Yeah, it wasn't God's will. It wasn't God's will. I didn't say that too. I mean, come on. So then text somebody and say, I'm not going to meet you for coffee today because I feel like I don't want to go. How about that for some responsibility? How about that? How about going that route? I'm just saying, okay, I don't feel like going. Not because it wasn't God's will. I can't make it. I can't make it because I'm not feeling up to it. I have a friend. Oh my goodness. I have a friend who has done this to me for a lot of years. And I don't think they're going to listen to this podcast. And it's not my besties. It's not my tribe. Just in case anybody from tribe is listening. It's none of nobody that listens to this podcast is this about. I didn't have a conversation, but anyway, so the situation is this person would cancel on me at the last minute. They would ask me, they would be the one to ask me to get together, and then they would cancel for a million reasons. They've actually called in sick on me so many times. Like one time, okay, you don't feel well, something's not right, but that has tended to be the person's default to say, I'm not feeling well, I'm not going to make it. And I really know, I have known what's actually going on. And what has actually been going on is there's some self-confidence stuff, and it has nothing to do with me. It's just how they feel. And if they feel that if they're not feeling so great about whatever in life, if they're not feeling very, you know, if their personal morale is down, they don't feel like going out. And so they'll just cancel at the last minute. And instead of saying to me, you know what, Dawn, I know that I have canceled on you at the last minute. I know that we have a good time, we get together, but sometimes I don't feel great about stuff. I just, my personal morale is down and I'm just not up for socializing. Like how hard, and it's hard for people to do this. And in a space that we're moving into this shift and all this, credibility, responsibility, character, and integrity is all inclusive to this. There is no separation to living heart-centered and moving into this multi-dimensional new earth thing, because it's a deeper call to love. And if it's a deeper call to love, then what would love do? It would just be honest. It would be forthright. It would be, you know, upfront about and honest about here's how I'm feeling. You know, I can't believe that it would be that hard to say, I honestly don't feel up to it. And it's like, because people know after a while, people get to know you. You get to know people based on their habits and their patterns and their cycles. And so, and it's not judging. It's just when something has happened several times with a particular person, what does that do? It builds a perspective. It builds a perspective about someone. You get perspective about people with how they habitually behave. And the last time this person did this, it was a few months ago. And I always know. I always know in my gut. And someone's letting me know because I always have a feeling. I always get this feeling like they're going to cancel again. And sure enough, that's exactly what happened. And I had to be honest this time. I had to be honest. This has been going on for years. And so why would you put up with that for several years? I know. So it's like kind of it's some of it's on me because you have to be willing to have a conversation. And it's just because I know them. I know how they are. I didn't want to rock the boat, blah, blah, blah. And it's not that I'm not a keeper of my own. I don't, you know, practice what I preach. But so I let them know. I said, you know, this has been going on for a lot of years. And it's very disappointing when I've made plans and I'm so busy nowadays and my days are full and I have a lot going on. There's a lot I'm trying to accomplish. And so when I make time for you, I could have done something else with that time or made plans with somebody else or whatever. And I don't think they were too crazy about me telling them this. I don't think they were too crazy about it. But here's the thing. 56 years old. We're not 16, we're 56. So add four more decades to that. You know, we're just not, it's we're adults. And at some point, and then somebody, you know, the spiritualism side will say, well, you know, they're on a different timeline than you are. They're in a different vibration. They're on a different frequency. And I understand that. I do. I understand it. But it's not to be used as a scapegoat. To just excuse everything and just keep excusing. And there are these memes that go around that say, you know, keep going with the flow. I mean, I'm a flow girl through and through. I saw Avatar, The Way of Water. I highly recommend it. If none of you have seen it, go see Avatar. Rent it. Not rent it. Listen to me. Rent it. Watch it on wherever it's going to be. Avatar, The Way of Water. You have to see this movie. Please see this movie. Please see it. If you saw Avatar, that was 13 years ago. This was absolutely an outstanding film. It was incredible. I saw it in the middle of December. It was just amazing. And I knew when I was, and I don't go to the movies a lot, and I actually went myself. I went by myself to see this movie. And I knew, I'm like, this is going to be a theme for this year, the flow. Well, guess what? And characters flow. Responsibility is in the flow. Credibility is in the flow. Integrity is in the flow. It's keeping your word is all part of flow, because what is flow? What is the flow? What is flow? Love. That's flow. When you're in the flow, because you are the flow, you are the flow. We are all flow. We're not always aligned with it, but we are the flow. So what we mean by flow is love. So what does love do? Like I'm saying here, what would love do? And so somewhere, when you don't function, when we don't function out of a love space and we don't function in honesty or transparency, there's a fear there somewhere. There's an insecurity or a fear. You're afraid of thus and such. You feel insecure about thus and such. So important. So important to crush that fear. So important because that's part of the shift. Facing that fear is the shift. Facing fear. Facing it, dealing with your personal fears, plowing through it. How do you do it? You have to take action in spite of it. I know this well. I know this really well. Taking action when you feel nervous as hell or scared out of your mind. It's you take action. And when you take action, it's like things break off of you when you take action. You know, it's a combination of the stillness, the quietness, the prayer, the meditation, the yoga mat. It's a combination of that, but also taking action, you know, and magic is definitely in the action. And so, word and credibility. So I've covered those talking points. I'm going to move into this now. And so a lot of people will kind of wonder about others, like, well, I wonder, you know, well, why isn't he communicating? Why isn't she communicating? Why do they do this? Why do they do that? And they question the behaviors and the actions and the responses and the reactions of other people. Instead of you just kind of taking the bull by the horns and getting your own self in alignment to your love, to your self-respect, it turns into taking a seat. Like you're more seated in the wound, past wound, seated in a fear space that causes you to wonder what everybody else is doing all the time or why everybody else is doing what they're doing. And so you're functioning, you will function out of that being seated in that fear space and wondering what everybody else is doing instead of saying, okay, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to be this way. I'm going to just stay aligned with my own self. I'm going to heal and just stay on my own personal development journey. Because when you get to a place where you're really healed, where you've done the brunt of your work, the work never ends. It never ends. And what I mean by that is it's not that you have this the deep healing work to continue to do. It's like fine tuning and adjustments. There's always adjustments along the way. Nobody is 100% aware. There are things that we all do that we might not be aware of. It's really the continuation of personal development is keeping a willingness of learning new awareness, keeping your awareness open, being willing to accept more things into your awareness and not feeling like rejected over it or feeling like you've done something wrong over it or feeling like, you know, I've made this terrible mistake. Those kinds of thinking is connected to a wound or a trauma somewhere. And that's where the deep healing work is. But when you have done the brunt of this work, you can just be honest. You can just be honest with people. You can just be honest and forthright and say, hey, you know, I can't do this right now. Or I can't give you time right now because this is what's happening or whatever it is. And you ask people's you ask people, will you give me some grace in this area while I figure this out? Will you lend me some understanding while I work on this? Will you hold space for me while I do this, that, or the other? Because there's so many people that are still out there at each other's throats. They're bickering. They're arguing. They're going back and forth. They're not resolving conflicts. They're not resolving disagreements. They're throwing stuff under the rug, which is really, you know, let's just move. Let's just forget about it. Doesn't work like that. When you don't clear something, I don't care who you are, because I have lived this my whole entire life. I've experienced this enough to know that when people just want to let things go, the energy is still hanging around in the energy field somewhere. And sure enough, the next argument or conflict that happens, that stuff gets drudged up. Or if it doesn't get drudged up and verbally brought up, you start acting out of that energy. And your tolerance level has reduced as a result of not clearing that initial issue up. So resentment in the background is building. It's like the operating system is running in the background. And you have this operating system running in the background that's accumulating all this energy. And then sure enough, something happens and it's like, bam, somebody blows up. Somebody blows up because you're not being honest. You're not being forthright. You're not being upfront. Well, because we're spiritual, we let stuff go. We're heart-based. I love people. We just let things go. I mean, you know, do we have to talk about absolutely everything? Like exactly, let me break down and give you a synopsis as to why I was 5 minutes late today. No, I'm not talking about that sort of an extreme. But when there's a series of things, when there's stuff going on, or, you know, if something is kind of hovering in the space and you don't have an answer, you're wondering why someone's doing something, or you're wondering what's going on, just ask someone. Because that wondering will turn to judgment. Wondering turns to judgment if you don't ask. Wondering turns to judgment where fear isn't cleared. It's okay to wonder, but it goes the way of judgment and criticism when fear is the underlying driver, if this makes sense. The more clear you are, you're able to just say, hey, what's going on? You know, and there's no suspicion. There's no negative thought about it. For years and years, I lived, you know, a ways back where there was always something going on in someone's head about what, how do I explain this? Whether there was just always, you know, like a curiosity or a suspicion as to people's real motives, let's say. And if you're in a place where you're constantly questioning a spouse, a friend, a coworker, whatever it is, motives, that is definitely not healthy. And I don't really know that it's on the end of the other person more than something that something maybe was happened in your past or life or something that causes you not to trust people, or you don't trust that, you don't trust their motives, you don't trust what they're doing. And so this is what people do. They take their mistrust and they turn it into discernment. And I know I did a podcast on discernment, and I don't know if I talked about this, but there's a difference between suspicion and discernment. And so where there's fear that hasn't been cleared and where there's a wound that hasn't been healed, you start to, you know, you have mistrust for people. You kind of don't trust where they're coming from because you're not aligned within yourself, which is what this means, follow through to you. And so if you're not aligned with your own self and you don't trust yourself, you're going to have a very hard time trusting other people. You're going to have a hard time in relationships. You're going to have a hard time wondering what is going on, ascertaining what's going on. So that suspicion, what people do is they'll deem it to be discernment, and it's not discernment, because discernment is something you know within your heart body, and it's something that you just know, but it's not on the negative side of, it's not like a cynical thing. Real discernment isn't cynical. It's not cynical. It's not suspicious. It's not dark. It's not like that. And a lot of people are saying, using discernment, they say, oh, I'm just discerning. This is what I discern. It's like, no, you don't trust these people. You have a discernment issue. You have a suspicious issue. There's a trust issue somewhere. You're not discerning this about this person. You're somewhere. There's something past, wounded, stuck energy somewhere that is causing you to see things through that lens. I have to write this down. Discernment isn't dark. I'm just going to write that down real quick. So 52 minutes, my goodness. Being forthright is being in alignment, you know, trusting yourself. I already talked about the spiritual scapegoating. That's just rampant. The spiritual scapegoating. Well, I'm just not, the energy's too much. I can't, the energy's too much. The vibe. I don't like the vibe. I don't like their energy, blah, 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 blah. All these can be true. They can be legitimate, but you have to connect via communication. There has to be a communication piece in the mix. And as far as telepathy, which does exist, I don't recommend in this moment that you try to telepathically communicate with people unless you know for a fact that both of you are on that wavelength where you can just communicate in silence to each other. I mean, I think one day we will get there. I don't know if it's happening too significantly right now in this moment. And I'm not mocking it. I'm not making fun of it. But talking works. Texting, can we have a conversation? Can we have this conversation? Can we smooth this out? Can we work this out? It works. The unattractive competition is a thing. And so the wondering leads to this. You know, the wondering leads to creating a story in your mind that doesn't exist. And so you're competing now. And now you're like, well, I'm not going to do this, or I'm not going to do that. Or, well, I'm just not going to do ABC 1, 2, 3. I mean, these things are they're ego driven. It's chip on the shoulder. It's not a loving flow of energy. Cause something is, you're disconnected. You're not in alignment. And so with the business and the friends and all these things, you want to be clear within you. You want to be clear within yourself, and you want to be able to be honest and not be afraid of how the other person's going to react. Because as long as you're honest and it's said in the right way, the other person, how they react isn't your responsibility. It's just how you bring it forth, how you bring it across. And as long as your heart's in the right place, then you've done the right thing. And there's just so much in the relationship space now. I had a conversation today with someone who I talk to them every Thursday morning. We were talking about business. We were talking about MLMs. And sometimes all a person has to do is hear those three letters, MLM, and they run like hell. They want nothing to do with it. They don't want to know nothing about no MLM. And I used to be part of that. I was one of the people that felt that way, because my ex-husband was very much into this, and there were a few of them and it didn't go well. And so I had a bitter taste in my mouth. And then I ended up getting involved in an MLM pretty hardcore back in 2012. And then, you know, I didn't have the greatest experience with it. And so I don't have a bitter taste in my mouth about it anymore. But there's a lot of products, MLM products, that are excellent. They're really good products. The issue with MLM is not so much the product, it's how people handle it. It's the character surrounding it. It's the credibility surrounding it. And a lot of people in MLMs are very spiritual people. They're either Christians, or they're spiritual people, or they're just sort of very positive people. They're motivation-oriented people. And the products are amazing, but it's just how they go about it. And so I think it was yesterday, the day before, somebody in Facebook wrote me, they sent me a friend request, and then they wrote me a message about their product. They don't even know me. They didn't even take the time to get to know me. They didn't try to develop a connection or anything. They just sent me a friend request, sent me a message in my inbox, and said, it was probably all the paragraphs and the pictures and the links and all this stuff offering me this business. I said, oh, heck no. You know, you don't know me. So I blocked the messenger part, and I did not accept their friend request, because there's no credibility here. There's no credibility. You're just coming after me for business. And I don't deprive business people of trying to earn a living or trying to sell their products and stuff. Absolutely not, or promote their products. But commerce was meant to be connection-oriented, relationship-oriented, caring about the end user, caring about the customer, the patient, the client, the service around it. And it's just become a huge, massive-ass moneymaker, MLM. And people know this. They know it. They call it the multi-level, you know, is this a pyramid scheme? They call it a pyramid scheme. You know, I mean, the corporate world is a pyramid scheme. There's a pyramid no matter what. There's always a CEO or someone that started the company somewhere. If you build your, the positive side to this is, if you build your downline and you build your distributors and your connections wisely, and if you do it well with a heart that you really want to help people, you'll do really well and you'll sustain those connections and those relationships. But if you're just money driven and you're just looking to make a buck and push a product and try to get it on the ground floor to just make the money, 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 I've seen it fail. And I could rattle off 5 companies where I've seen this happen. And so we were talking about that, you know, and so people, he's like, it happens to me all day, Dawn. People come to me all the time. And, you know, cause he's an author of books and stuff, and he's successful with that and what he's trying to do. And it's like, always, someone always has, you know, but you gotta have character in business. And I'm going to say, keep saying it. Character is spiritual. You got to have character in business. You have to have character. There has to be like credibility somewhere. It takes time to build credibility. And I know the people I can really trust. And I know the people that it's like, you know, some people it's like they want, it's weird. They want to be connected to you, but they don't feel like it. They don't feel, there's just something that it's like, well, why are we doing this? Why do you want to be connected to me? Are you going to ask me how I'm actually doing? Are you curious how I'm really doing? Do you care about my well-being? And I think, again, follow through to you. The connection with you, the alignment with you is what causes you, and I'm saying you generally, any of us, our connection with ourselves is what causes us, is what enables us to care about other people, to really care about other people's well-being and how they're really doing. You know, I mean, I'm an empath to the bone. That's never going to change. I've been like this my whole life. When I say I got you. There's no deal. There's no contract. It's not, well, what have you done for me lately? And why did all these things for you in a row? And you've done nothing for me lately. And I don't keep score. It's just, when I got you, I got you. And so that's the thing, is the connection with yourself. And there will sometimes be people that you can sense that, do they care about your well-being for real? Or are they just kind of hanging around? You know, I'm not a hang around person. The people that I consider tribe people, they're not hang around people either. And they know that I'm not a hang around person. I'll kind of hang around. There are people I meet for coffee. There are people that, you know, that I've known for a lot of years, meet for coffee, but you have like boundaries and a you know, a pulse on the level of personal information and business life, the personal life that you share with people. But the hang around to just hang around, sometimes this hanging around, they just want to know your business. They just want to know what you're up to. They really have deep jealousy, competitive issues. And so that's where they're really coming from. And I know this. I've experienced this. You can feel it. You can feel when there's a free flow, because here's the thing, the free flow and the, you know, you care about people. You're just light. You just care. You're just there. There isn't like you turn your back and you feel that there's a judgment going forth in the energy space. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you ever been around people like this? Have you ever been around like you, I don't know, maybe a group of guys, group of girls, whatever it is, or wherever you're going and whatever you're doing, and you leave, you walk out of the room to be go get a drink, use the restroom, or just step out for a minute, and as you're walking away, you feel that kind of energy where there's like this whispering going on, or even just a thought kind of goes out towards you. You know, I'm so blessed to be around people that this doesn't exist. And as of late, I'm participating, I'm connected to some the most beautiful people. And there's something that I'm doing, and I'll be sharing it down the road. It's just, there isn't that weird, judgy, wonky energy anywhere near these people. Nowhere near these people. They're just pure, loving people that have your best interest at heart. There isn't like thoughts that go off of, you know, like a suspicious, well, wondering what your problem is, or wondering what your motive is, or wondering like what's really going on, you know, the sizing you up type stuff. I mean, you can feel when someone's sizing you up. You can feel when someone is not being genuine. You can feel when someone has like, they're kind of in a non-trusting space. I can feel these things. I'm pretty sure you could feel these things. It doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good to be around people like this that are just wondering, like, you know, some people wonder how much money you make. Some people wonder all kinds of things about your personal business. It's like, well, why? Why? Just be present. Be present. So it's the follow through to you. The follow through, everything follows through from you. That's how this works. The measure of connection and integrity and character and self-respect that you house within yourself, that you have for your own self, is the measure of is how it's going to show up in relationships. That's just the fact of how it works. It shows up in relationships. And everybody, you have a signature energy and blueprint. You have your own signature energy. And I'm trying to think where I heard this recently. Somewhere I was hearing this conversation about checking in with other people and how they experience your energy. And so what I mean by that is it's like your vibration. It's not, you know, if you're quiet or if you're loud, it's not that, although that does demonstrate some energy, but it's about like how people experience your presence around. Do they feel that you're safe? Do they feel that you're loving? Do they feel that you're genuine? Do they feel that you're forthright? Do they feel that you're real? You know, things like that. And it's cool to check in with people once in a while and say, hey, you know, how do you experience my energy? I feel people's energy through social media. You know, I really can. And there's a bunch of us that do. You just get a sense of people's energy. I've been doing that for a very long time. And there's just certain people that you interact with, and you just have a sense of their energy. And this one woman, she's a businesswoman. I love her. She's part of the morning crew. I've been on the phone with her several times, and she's great. And just what I expected. The first time we got on the phone, she's just what I expected by how she interacts, you know, in the news feed, and how she looks, you know, the pictures. She's a beautiful woman. How she looks, you know, it's just how she looks and just how she interacts is exactly what she is on the phone. Just a sweetheart, upstanding, charactered woman. There's no weird, wonky, you know, suspicious. I mean, some people just have suspicious energy. They just have just this, they're constantly either trying to read people, trying to figure people out. They're constantly suspicious, you know, and you just know it. You can't bring that to anybody's attention too. That's the kicker. That's a tough one. You can't have a conversation with someone and say, you know, I feel like you're like sizing me up. I feel like you're being suspicious of me. Like that's, people don't respond well to that, especially if they're guilty of it. It's going to be a shitstorm. It's not going to go over well. You cannot have these conversations. You have to just distance yourself. It's awkward, you know, especially when you like people. If you like someone, but you just know how they function. And it is possible to like and even love people, but how they function doesn't work for you. It's just not like, it's not healthy at times. But so I think I'm going to stop right there, an hour and 6 minutes in. I know this wasn't the most sexiest topic. It may not have been, but I felt it was needed. You know, obviously the squad thought so, the universe, because that's what came to me. That's what was given to me. And I believe that. I flowed through this as best as I could. And I hope that you got something out of this. I really do. Follow through to you. You know, follow through to you, because all the business and the friends and the family and all these things that we want and that we need connections with each other, all comes out of the relationship we have with ourselves, the respect we have, you know, the character that we sustain, the integrity, you know, the credibility that we have, even with our own selves, you know, following through, keeping your own word to yourself. If you can't follow through on things for yourself, that's a tough one. But you know, that's you have everything that you need. Every last bit of all of the resources that you need is always within you. It's you know, I mean, that's not anything so profound. It is true though. But so I'm going to stop right there. Again, I'm stopping. I appreciate you all being here. I haven't seen you in a while, Frank. I'm glad to see you. GP man 45. Thank you, Carrie, you guys. Ellie, I think she's still here. Thanks for coming in. I'm definitely going to be back next Tuesday. But so my name is Dawn Shale. You can find me at www.dawnshale.com. You can learn more there about how I coach and counsel clients. Do avail yourself to the podcast tab where all the library is listed. And this is going to be there shortly in about 45 minutes. And then there's the feedback tab where clients and colleagues have the things that they've said about me and stuff like this. And this podcast will also be listed in iHeartRadio, Spotify, Amazon Music, and YouTube. Feel free to go to my YouTube channel and subscribe, Living Light, Dark to Dawn, Rock Solid. And it's just a matter of all just picking a video and just pushing play. And it's that simple. Sometimes people have a hard time finding it. This is also going to be posted in the social medias, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram after this is done processing. If you feel that this episode would benefit anybody you know, such as friends, family, or co-workers, send them the link to this podcast. Let them know who I am. Let them hear it. If you feel that it would give them insight or whatever they need in this moment. And if you or someone you know could use some help or some healing or moving energy or whatever it might be, send them my way or look me up, go to my website, because I can only serve you so much through this podcast, but I can do way more substantially one-on-one. I'm available to give more. There are different levels that we can work together. If you or that person's looking for any answers or some direction in your own life, I'd love to talk to you. I'd love to get to know you better through a free 30-minute intuitive call. So don't hesitate. And have an amazing rest of your morning, afternoon, and evening, wherever you might be listening, into your weekend, the first weekend of June. Enjoy the full moon, moon gazers. Do enjoy the full moon. And like I said, I'll be back on Tuesday. I have no idea what I'm talking about. You're going to have to tune in to find out. In the meantime, live love, live blessed, live self-respected, live lit. And I will talk at you soon. I love you. I love you all. Take care. Bye-bye. Since you know me, I was a lonely soul, but that's the only. A little wiser now from what you show me. Hey, I feel again.